and Miles to Go Before I Sleep, by William F. Nolan. He knew, to the exact minute, when he was going to die, and Earth was too far away to reach. And Miles to Go Before I Sleep, by William F. Nolan. Alone within the humming ship, deep in its honeycombed metal chambers, Murdoch waited for death. While the rocket moved inexorably toward Earth, an immense silver needle threading the dark fabric of space, he waited calmly through the final hours, knowing that the verdict was absolute, that hope no longer existed. Electronically self-sufficient, the ship was doing its job perfectly, the job it had been built to do. After 20 years in space, the ship was taking Robert Murdoch home. Home. Earth. Thayerville, a small town in Kansas. Clean air, a shaded street, and a white two-story house at the end of the block. Home, after 2 decades among the stars. Sitting quietly before the round port, seeing and not seeing the endless darkness surrounding him, Murdoch was remembering. He remembered the worried face of his mother, her whispered prayers for his safety as he mounted the rocket ramp those 20 years ago. He could still feel the final crushing handshake of his father moments before the outer airlock slid closed. His mother had been 55 then, his father 63. It was almost impossible to believe that they were now old and white-haired. And what of himself? He was now 41, and space had weathered him as the plains of Kansas had weathered his father. He, too, had labored as his father had labored, but on strange, alien worlds, under suns far hotter than Sol. Murdoch's face was square and hard-featured, his eyes dark and deep under the thrusting ledges of bone. He had changed as they had changed. He was a stranger going home to strangers. Carefully, Murdoch unfolded his mother's last letter, written in her flowery, archaic hand, and received just before Earth takeoff. "Dearest Bob, oh, we are so excited. Your father and I listened to your voice on the tape over and over, telling us that you were coming home to us at last. We are both so eager to see you, son. As you know, we have not been too well of late. Your father's heart does not allow him out much any more, and I have had a few fainting spells over the past months. But Dr. Tom says that we are all right, and you are not to worry. Just hurry home to us, Bob. We both pray God you will come back safely. All our love, Mother." Robert Murdoch put the letter aside and clenched his fists. Only brief hours remained to him, and the small Kansas town of Thayerville was an impossible distance across space. He knew he would never reach it alive. The lines of an ancient poem by Robert Frost whispered through his mind. "But I have promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep." He had promised his parents that he would come home, and he meant to keep that promise. The doctors had shown him that it was impossible. They had charted his death. They had told him when his heart would stop beating, when his breathing would cease. Death, for Robert Murdoch, was a certainty. His alien disease was incurable. But they had listened to his plan. They had listened and agreed. Now, with less than a half an hour of life remaining, Murdoch was walking down one of the ship's long corridors, his boot heels ringing on the narrow metal walkway. He was ready at last to keep his promise. Murdoch paused before a wall storage locker, twisted a small dial. A door slid smoothly back. He looked up at the tall man standing motionless in the darkness. Reaching forward, Murdoch made a quick adjustment. The tall man stepped down into the corridor, and the light flashed in his deep-set eyes, almost hidden behind thrusting ledges of bone. The man's face was hard and square-featured. "My name is Robert Murdoch," said the tall figure in the neat patrol uniform. "I am 41 years of age, a rocket pilot going home to Earth." He paused. "And I am sound of mind and body." Murdoch nodded slowly. "Indeed you are," he said. "How much longer do you have, sir?"
"Another 10 minutes, perhaps a few seconds beyond that," replied Murdoch.
I'm sorry," said the tall figure. Murdoch smiled. He knew that a machine, however perfect, could not experience the emotion of sorrow, but it eased him to hear the words. "You will be fine," he thought. "You will serve well in my place, and my parents will never suspect that their son has not come home to them."
"It must all be perfect," said Murdoch.
"Of course," said the machine. "When the month I am to spend with them is over, they'll see me board a rocket for space. And they'll understand that I cannot return to them for another 20 years. They will accept the fact that a spaceman must return to the stars, that he cannot leave the service before he is 60. Let me assure you, sir, it will all go well." Yes, Murdoch told himself, it will go well. Every detail has been considered. My voice is his voice, my habits his own. The tapes I have pre-recorded will continue to reach them at specific intervals until their death. They will never know I'm gone.
"Are you ready now, sir?" the tall figure asked gently.
Murdoch drew in his breath. "Yes," he said, "I'm ready now." And they began to walk down the long corridor. Murdoch remembered how proud his parents had been when he was finally accepted for space training, the only boy in Thayerville to be chosen. But then it was only right that he should have been the one. The other boys, those who failed, had not lived the dream as he had lived it. From the moment he had watched the first moon rocket land, he had known beyond any possible doubt that he would become a rocket man. He had stood there in the cold December of 1980, a boy of 12, watching the great rocket fired down from space, watching it thaw and blacken the frozen Earth. He had known that one day he would follow it back to the stars, to vast and alien horizons, to worlds past imagining. He remembered his last night on Earth, 20 long years ago. When he had felt the pressing immensity of the vast and terrible universe surrounding him as he lay in his bed. He remembered the sleepless hours before dawn, when he could feel the tension building within the single room, within himself lying there in the heated stillness of the small, white house. He remembered the rain near morning, drumming the roof, and the thunder roaring powerfully across the Kansas sky. And then, somehow, the thunder's roar blended into the deep atomic roar of the rocket, carrying him away from Earth, away to the burning stars, away, away. A tall figure in a neat patrol uniform closed the outer airlock and watched the body drift into blackness. The ship and the android were one. Two complex and perfect machines doing their job. For Robert Murdoch, the journey was over. The long miles had come to an end. Now he would sleep forever in space. When the rocket landed, the crowds were there, waving and shouting out Murdoch's name as he appeared on the silver ramp. He smiled and raised his hand in salute, standing there, tall in the sun, his splendid dress uniform reflecting the light in a thousand glittering patterns. At the far end of the ramp, two figures waited.
an old man bowed and trembled over a cane, and a seamed and wrinkled woman, her hair blowing white, her eyes shining. When the tall spaceman reached them, they embraced him feverishly, clinging tight to his arms. Their son had returned. Robert Murdoch had come home from space.
"Well," said a man at the fringe of the crowd, "there they go."
His companion sighed and shook his head.
"I still don't think it's right, somehow. It just doesn't seem right to me." "It's what they wanted, wasn't it?"
asked the other.
"It's what they wrote in their wills. They vowed their son would never come home to death. In another month he'll be gone anyway. Back for another 20 years. Why ruin it all for him?"
The man paused, shading his eyes against the sun.
"And they are perfect, aren't they? He'll never know."
"I suppose you're right," nodded the second man.
"He'll never know."
And he watched the old man and old woman and the tall son until they were out of sight. The end of "And Miles to Go Before I Sleep" by William F. Nolan.
A Matter of Magnitude by Al Sevcik. When you're commanding a spaceship over a mile long and armed to the teeth, you don't exactly expect to be told to get the hell out. A Matter of Magnitude by Al Sevcik. The ship, for reasons that had to do with the politics of appropriations, was named Senator Joseph L. Holloway, but the press and the public called her Big Joe. Her captain, Six-Star Admiral Heselton, thought of her as Great Big Joe, and never fully got over being awestruck at the size of his command.
"She's a mighty big ship, Rogers," he said proudly to the navigator, ignoring the latter's rather vacant stare and fixed smile. "More than a mile long and wider than hell." He waved his hands expansively. "She's never touched down on Earth, you know. Never will. Too big for that. They built her on the moon."
"The cost?"
"Well..."
Swiveling his chair around, Heselton slowly surveyed the ship's control room with a small, satisfied smile. The two pilots, sitting far forward, almost hidden by their banks of instruments. The radar operators idly watching their scopes. The three flight engineers sitting intently at their enormous control consoles. And just behind, the radio shack, its closed doors undoubtedly hiding a game of cards. For weeks now, as the Big Joe moved across the galaxy's uncharted fringe, the radio bands had been completely dead, except, of course, for the usual star-static hissing and burping in the background. Turning back again to his navigator, Heselton smiled modestly and noticed that the Big Joe was undisputedly the largest, most powerful, most feared, and most effective spaceship in the known universe. As always, Rogers nodded in agreement. The fact that he'd heard it 100 times didn't make it any less true. Big Joe, armed with every weapon known to Terran technology, was literally the battleship to end all battleships. Ending battleships and battles was in fact her job, and she did it well. For the first time, the galaxy was at peace. With a relaxed sigh, Heseltine leaned back to gaze at the stars and contemplate the vastness of the universe, compared to which even Big Joe was an insignificant dot.
"Well," said Rogers, "time for another course check. I'll..."
He jumped back, barely avoiding the worried lieutenant who exploded upon them from the radio shack.
"A signal, sir. Damn close on the VHS band. The transmission is completely overriding the background noise."
He waved excitedly to someone in the radio shack, and an overhead speaker came to life, emitting a distant, crackly, grunting sound.
"It's audio of some sort, sir, but there's lots more to the signal than that."
In one motion, Heseltine's chair snapped forward. His right fist hit the red emergency alert button on his desk, and his left snapped on the ship's intercom. Lights dimmed momentarily as the powerful emergency drive units snapped into action, and the ship echoed with the sound of 2,000 men running to battle stations.
"Bridge to radar, report."
"Radar to bridge, all clear."
Heseltine stared incredulously at the intercom.
"Radar to bridge, repeating, all clear. Admiral, we've got two men on every scope. There's nothing anywhere."
A new voice cut in on the speaker.
"Radio track to bridge."
Frowning, Heseltine answered.
"Bridge. Come in, radio track, we're listening."
"Sir,"
the crisp voice of the radio track section commander had an excited tinge.
"Sir, Doppler calculations show that the source of those signals is slowing down somewhere to our right. It's acting like a spaceship, sir, that's coming to a halt."
The admiral locked eyes with Rogers for a second, then shrugged.
"Slow the ship and circle right. Radio track, can you get me a posting on the object's position?"
"No can do, sir. Doppler effect can't be used on a slow-moving source. It's still off to our right, but that's the best I can say."
"Sir,"
another voice chimed in,
"this is fire control. We've got our directional antennas on the thing. It's either directly right or directly left of the ship, matching speed with us exactly."
"Either to our right or left?"
"That's the best we can do, sir, without radar help."
"Admiral, sir,"
the lieutenant who had first reported the signal came running back. "Judging from the frequency and strength, we think it's probably less than 100 miles away."
"Less than 100? Of course, we can't be positive, sir."
Heseltine whirled back to the intercom.
"Radar! That thing is practically on our neck. What the hell's the matter with the equipment?"
The radar commander's voice showed distinct signs of strain.
"Can't help it, Admiral. The equipment is working perfectly. We've tried the complete range of frequencies. 25 different sets are in operation. We're going blind looking. There is absolutely nothing, nothing at all."
For a moment, the bridge was silent, except for a clacking grunting from the overhead speakers, which, if anything, sounded louder than before.
"It's TV, sir."
The radio lieutenant came running in again.
"We've unscrambled the image. Here."
The communication screen on Heseltine's desk glowed for a moment, then flashed into light. The figure was clearly alien, though startlingly humanoid, at least from the waist up, which was all that showed on the screen. A large mouth, slightly bulging eyes, gave it a somewhat jovial, frog-like demeanor. Seated at a desk similar to Heseltine's, wearing a gaudy uniform profusely sewn with a variety of insignia, it was obviously Heseltine's counterpart, the commander of the alien vessel.
"Looks like we've contacted a new race. Let's return the call, Lieutenant."
A tiny red light glowed beneath the miniature camera on Heseltine's desk, and almost at once the alien's face registered obvious satisfaction. It waved a six-finger hand in an unorthodox but friendly greeting. Heseltine waved back. The alien pointed to his mouth, made several clacking, grunting sounds, and moved a hand on his desk. The scene switched to another alien standing in front of what looked like a blackboard, with a piece of chalk in his hand. The meaning was clear.
"Lieutenant, have this transmission switched to linguistics section. Maybe those guys can work some sort of language.
The screen blanked out. Hasseltine leaned back, tense, obviously worried. Hesitantly, he reached out and touched a button on the intercom.
Astronomy?
Professor, there's a ship right next door somewhere that should stand out like King Kong in a kindergarten.
I know, Admiral. I've been listening to the intercom. Our optical equipment isn't designed for close-range work, but we've been doing the best we can, tried everything from infrared through ultraviolet. If there's a ship out there, I'm afraid it's invisible.
Beads of sweat sprinkled on Hesseltine's forehead.
This is bad, Rogers. Mighty bad.
Nervously, he walked across to the right of the bridge and stood, hands clasped behind his back, staring blankly out at the blackness and the scattered stars.
I know there is a ship out there, and I know that the ship simply can't be invisible, not to radar and optics.
What makes you sure there is only one, sir? Hesseltine cracked his fists together.
My God, Rogers, you're right. There might be.
The intercom crackled. This is fire control again, sir. I think we've got something on the radiation detectors.
Good work. What did you find?
Slight radioactivity, typical of interstellar drive mechanisms, somewhere off to our right. Can't tell exactly where, though.
How far away is it?
I don't know, sir. Heston's hands dropped to his side.
Thanks, he said, for the help.
His desk TV flashed into life with a picture of the smiling alien commander.
This is the linguistics section, Admiral. The aliens understand a fairly common galactic symbology. I believe we can translate simple messages for you now.
Ask him where the hell he is, Hesseltine snapped without thinking. Then instantly regretted it as the alien's face showed unmistakable surprise. The alien's smile turned into an almost unbelievable grin. He turned sideways to speak to someone out of sight of the camera, and suddenly burst into a series of roaring cackles.
He's laughing, sir, the translator commented unnecessarily.
The joke was strictly on the aliens. Hasseltine's face whitened in quick realization.
Rogers, they don't know we can't see them.
Look, sir. The navigator pointed to a TV screen and a brilliantly clear image of Big Joe shimmering against the galaxy, lit by millions of stars. Every missile point, even the military numerals along her nose, were clearly visible.
They're rubbing it in, Rogers, showing us what we look like to them.
Hasseltine's face was chalk. They could blast Big Joe apart, piece by piece, the most powerful ship in the galaxy.
Maybe, said Rogers, the second most powerful.
Without answering, Hesseltine turned and looked out again in empty space and millions of steady, unwinking stars. His mind formed an image of a huge, ethereal spaceship, missile ports open, weapons aimed directly at Big Joe. The speaker interrupted his nightmare.
This is fire control, Admiral. With your permission, I'll scatter a few C-bombs.
Hesseltine leapt for the microphone. Are you out of your mind? We haven't the slightest idea of the forces that guy has. We might be in the center of a whole blooming fleet. Ever think of that?
The alien's face, still smirking, appeared again on the screen.
He says, said the interpreter, that he finds the presence of our armed ship very annoying.
Hesseltine knew what he had to do.
Tell him, he said, swallowing hard, that we apologize. This part of the galaxy is strange to us.
He says he is contemplating blasting us out of the sky.
Hesseltine said nothing, but he longed to reach out and throttle the grinning alien face.
However, the interpreter continued, he will let us go safely if we leave immediately. He says to send an unarmed diplomatic vessel next time, and maybe his people will talk to us. Thank him for his kindness. Heselton's jaws clenched so tightly that they ached. He says, said the interpreter, to get the hell out. The grinning face snapped off the screen, but the cackling laughter continued to reverberate in the control room until the radio shack finally turned off the receiver. Reverse course, the admiral ordered quietly. Maximum drive. 1,000 missile launchers, designed to disintegrate solar systems, were deactivated. Hundreds of gyros swung the mile-long ship end for end and stabilized her on a reverse course. Drive units big enough to power several major cities whined into operation. Anti-grav generators, with the strength to shift small planets, counterbalanced the external acceleration, and the ship moved away, with a speed approaching that of light. Well, muddled Heseltine, that's the first time Big Joe has ever had to retreat. As if it were his own personal failure, he walked slowly across the control room and down the corridor toward his cabin.
Admiral!
Lost in thought, Heseltine barely heard the call.
Admiral, look!
Pausing at the door to his cabin, Heseltine turned to face the ship's chief astronomer, running up, waving two large photographs.
Look, sir!
The professor gasped for breath.
We thought this was a spot on the negative, but one of the men got curious and enlarged it about 100 times.
He held up one of the photos. It showed a small, fuzzy, but unmistakable spaceship.
No wonder we couldn't spot it with our instruments.
Heseltine snatched it out of his hand.
I see what you mean. This ship must have been thousands of miles.
The professor shook his head.
No, sir. As a matter of fact, it was quite close by.
But
we figure that the total length of the alien ship is roughly 1.5 inches.
The end of A Matter of Magnitude by Al Sivka.
Happy Ending by Henry Kuttner and C.L. Moore. Happy Ending by Henry Kuttner and C.L. Moore. This is the way the story ended. James Kelvin concentrated very hard on the thought of the chemist with the red mustache who had promised him $1 million. It was simply a matter of tuning in on the man's brain, establishing a rapport. He had done it before. Now it was more important than ever that he do it this one last time. He pressed the button on the gadget the robot had given him, and thought hard. Far off, across limitless distances, he found the rapport. He clamped on the mental tight beam. He wrote it. The red mustache man looked up, gaped, and grinned delightedly.
"So there you are," he said. "I didn't hear you come in. Good grief, I've been trying to find you for 2 weeks."
"Tell me one thing quick," Kelvin said. "What's your name?"
"George Bailey. Incidentally, what's yours?"
But Kelvin didn't answer. He had suddenly remembered the other thing the robot had told him about that gadget which established rapport when he pressed the button. He pressed it now, and nothing happened. The gadget had gone dead. Its task was finished, which obviously meant that he had at last achieved health, fame, and fortune. The robot had warned him, of course. The thing was set to do one specialized job. Once he got what he wanted, it would work no more. So Kelvin got the $1 million. And he lived happily ever after. This is the middle of the story. As he pushed aside the canvas curtain, something, a carelessly hung rope, swung down at his face, knocking the horn-rimmed glasses askew. Simultaneously, a vivid bluish light blazed into.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.